Not even a full month ago, the Aspen Ideas Festival was held here, and there was a full track devoted to the Middle East and really its importance to the world in geopolitical terms. We see daily I don't know if it's implosion or reorganization or whatever you want to call it in Egypt. We see vast war and destruction in Syria. We see the possibility of maybe renewed peace talks in the Palestinian territories and Israel. But often, a lot of these discussions obscure a broader understanding of what's going on in the region. And that is really one of opportunity. There are challenges, but there are really is a lot going on that we forget about when we watch the nightly news. It's also important to realize that a lot of those discussions on population growth and others actually underpin a lot of the political dynamics that are going on. Certainly, we have three fantastic fellows here to discuss this. Dheema Bibi is the Chief Executive Officer of INJAZ, a leading Jordanian youth organization and a member of Junior Achievement Worldwide. INJAZ is an independent nonprofit organization established in 1999 with a mission to inspire and prepare youth to become productive members of the society and succeed in the global economy. INJAZ today delivers its wide array of programs through a network of around 4,000 qualified volunteers from the private sector, and with the support of more than 300 corporations, its partners from the public sector and the civil society, promoting business entrepreneurship, social leadership, and essential business and interpersonal skills. Dheema is based in Jordan, and she is a member of the inaugural class of the Middle East Leadership Initiative. To my far left, Ghassan Hasbani is from Lebanon and the president of SAWT, foundation for, they do a lot of work in education and healthcare development in Lebanon. He is also the former CEO of the International Operations Group of Saudi Telecom Company. He joined Saudi Telecom from the global management consulting firm of Booz & Company, where he led the firm's Middle East communications and technology practice. He's a fellow of the second class of the Middle East Leadership Initiative. And finally, to my immediate left is Yoav Ventura, a successful entrepreneur and local thought leader in higher education and human capital management. He is the vice president of planning and strategy at University of the People, the world's first tuition-free, nonprofit, online academic institution dedicated to the democratization of higher education. Yoav is also the co-founder and managing partner of AKT, which he has led since 1999. AKT is a leading human capital management firm executing a vision of comprehensive talent management and strategic human capital development. Yoav is from Israel and is a member of the second class of the Middle East Leadership Initiative. So, first a caveat. The Middle East is one of the most diverse regions in the world, and so to lump it all together, which we're sort of going to do in this conversation, is a little bit of a fiction. It's sort of like George Bernard Shaw used to say about the United States and England, they're two peoples divided by a common language. And the Middle East is very much sort of that times 10. So I'd like to start, first with Ghassan. Maybe if you could set the scene a little bit and describe this broad region, and hopefully maybe not in terms of what we're watching in the news every night, but give us a little bit of depth.
Thank you. Well, this region spans, contrary to what people might think, spans multiple cultures, geographies. In fact, at least two continents, and a huge and diverse population, be it, as I said, culture, be it even religion, and also ethnicities. So I would guess today that our coverage of Middle East would include the North African part of the Middle East, which covers a bit of Africa, the Gulf, and the Levant area, Iran, and Turkey, the extended Middle East. And if we look at this entire geography, it encompasses nearly 400 million people living there. But what's fascinating about it is the growth rate of the population of that geography. It grows by about 8 to 10 million people every year. You can imagine the number of youth in this kind of growth situation. At the same time, 30% of this population is between the ages of 15 and 29. That's also a massive number compared to more stable economies. Interestingly, I would divide the region into kind of two parts. One is kind of Western Asia, that's the Levant, Iran, and Turkey. The other is the Gulf. In the Western Asia part, 85% of the youth, of the youth population, is actually unemployed at this point in time, while only 15% of that population is unemployed in the Gulf. So you can see that the poorer or the lower growth countries in terms of GDP have also an employment issue with this youth population. If we look, though, at the growth that is not related to oil growth today as it stands in the current global economic crisis, it's around 3.7 to 4%, which is not too bad considering what's happening to the rest of the world. It's just half of that of the growth of China. So effectively what that paints to us, a picture of a great opportunity for growth, for economic development, for education, for investments. But at the same time, it comes with a set of massive challenges related to youth unemployment predominantly, which is also related to education. And that can help explain a little bit what is happening currently in parts of the region in terms of the economic indicators that are leading a large portion of the population to look for significant change. And it's actually happening now. And that change by itself should, in one way or another, if it's managed properly and looked after properly by the concerned parties around the world, should result in a significant opportunity.
Absolutely. Dheema, you do a lot of work with youth in Jordan. When we were talking beforehand, I found it fascinating a lot of work you've done in sort of looking into the youth perspective of this. I think it's very easy to say, well, we've got a youth bulge, and so therefore what we need to do is educate them or finance them or whatever it is. But you've actually been talking to them. So what do they want? What are they talking about in the region?
Yeah, dealing with youth for the past 13 years on a daily basis, I just want to share one thing that I believe is extremely interesting. Youth this year, specifically this year, are much more optimistic than I've ever seen them before. They're very much hopeful. And if youth, who constitute more than 70% of the Arab population, are hopeful, I believe we as well should be hopeful. There are a lot of surveys that were conducted in the Arab region on youth and on what they believe their concerns are and what their priorities are. One of the most comprehensive surveys is the Asda Burson Marsteller, which highlights specific findings. One of them is that the youth today, for them, the number one priority is employment, finding jobs, and is fair pay. And that survey was done on 15 Arab countries. Their number one concern, or their most pressing issue and concern, is the rising cost of living and their inability to form families and rent houses and so on. And their number one cause of, or belief, the biggest obstacle hindering the growth in the Arab world, they believe, is the lack of democracy, in addition to the civil unrest, followed by the Arab-Israeli conflict and the uprisings that are happening today. So that's, in general, the situation. However, as I mentioned, what's most interesting is that they're more optimistic than ever before. They're hopeful. They are a generation. We should be hopeful because this generation of youth did what my generation and my parents' generation believed are is economically or is politically impossible. So we believe that they can do the economically impossible as well. They are the source of innovation for the region. They're the source of energy. They're the source of hope. And I think today our governments realize that they cannot be marginalized anymore, and they have to be included in the process of planning and in the process of the development in general.
So fulfilling the economic promises of the so-called Arab Spring to come on behind the political progress that was made,
absolutely,
or at least in process of being made. So you know, often it's when we talk about the youth bulge, you know, to put it in perspective, a number that is often thrown out is that in the next 15 years, just to meet the population growth in the region needs to create 50 million new jobs, just to sort of stand still. That's more jobs that have been created in the last 50 years combined. So it's a daunting challenge, and yet I think it is one, it's interesting that there is such optimism. You know, Israel is both part of and apart from this region, for obvious reasons. In a lot of ways, Israel can be and is an example to the rest of the region. Israel's done a lot of things right. They have a lot of challenges as well. Maybe you could talk a little bit about that. I know your background is often education and entrepreneurship, but I think that's, in a way, sort of part of the secret sauce that Israel has had.
Yeah, thank you. I think that Israel can definitely be considered as a success story of the region in terms of economical situation and growth. I think that some of the factors are maybe, there are a few fundamental reasons to grow any economy, I think. First of all is the rule of law, for example, and economical freedom. There is almost zero corruption in Israel. I think these are, I would say, critical ingredients in order to grow a healthy economy. But beyond that, there are some other catalysts for this process over the few last decades, which are very successful educational system, of course. Mainly the higher educational system. There is also something which is, I'm not sure if it's a truth, but something about the entrepreneurial mindset or DNA even of Israelis. People are really willing to take risks and to go for crazy ideas sometimes. Sometimes it works. Over the years, also, there was a development of a VC framework and system that really now helps to feed young entrepreneurs with capital. So this system works very well now in Israel, and it's quite easy to raise money if you have a good idea. I think this is quite unique elements in the Israeli economy, and I think that's some of the secret sauces.
Right. Well, I think that tracks a lot with a lot of people who have looked at the MENA region broadly, say, as sort of the ingredients for successful economic growth and what lacks right now to some extent. And that is essentially, one, policy change. You know, it's often been mentioned that it takes 60 steps to form a formal business in Egypt right now. It's the lack or the high cost of business failure, the lack of a bankruptcy code, the fact if you bounce a check, you go to jail in many areas in the region. So those are policy levels. And then two would be access to capital, something that Israel has taken very aggressive steps with the government and the private sector side. And the third area being education, that the much as we were talking about in the Central Valley, and I think the next panel will address, is that the education that is it is producing many college graduates is not producing people that can actually fill the jobs that are available. Dheema, maybe you could talk a little bit more about that, because I think education is something that you're really focused on.
Yes. I want to start with the fact that, building on what Ghassan just mentioned, we had a very high growth rate back in the 50s, 60s, 70s, up to late 80s, which led to what is known as the youth bulge, which was at its peak in 2005, youth bulge being the population between age 15 and 24. Now, previously, until the 90s, this huge population used to put a lot of pressure on the education system. So our governments used to put all their effort and focus on providing access to education, building schools, hiring teachers, closing the gender gap. So it was all the focus was on increasing literacy. Today, this age group is in their late 20s, early 30s, putting so much pressure for the past 10 years on the job market. So this is from the supply side. From the demand side, or from the government side, let me say, historically speaking, our governments in most of Arab countries in specific were the number one employer of this huge amount of graduates coming every year. Every year, by the way, there's a 3 million new grads and new job seekers that are pumped into the marketplace every year looking for jobs. Today, with the budget deficits, with the crisis, with the uprising, our governments cannot, our private sector cannot employ these numbers anymore. From the private sector side, to a large extent, we have a traditional private sector still, to a large extent, with not very diversified industry base, limited fields, the kinds of job even that the private sector is able to create are limited for low-scale labor and so on. So the private sector is unable to absorb this huge amount of graduates, leading, of course, to the issue of unemployment becoming worse and worse. The education system, yani, unfortunately, I have to say that we've been hearing about reforms in the education system for the past, at least I remember, for the past 20, 30 years. But we've been lacking, I think, guts, because we cannot do cosmetics when we talk about education reform. We cannot do makeup here and there. It has to be a surgical process. And I don't think we have enough guts to go there and to do that. And
is it a lack of resources or is it a lack of
guts?
Guts.
Yes, because I mean, the education system is an elephant. It's huge. And when you talk about surgical process, and you're talking about taking it from its roots, and you know that will shake lots of things. A huge percentage of the population are teachers or working in the education system, and there are lots of issues when it comes to education. Content is an issue. The delivery method is a major issue. The management of the school, and we've just heard the story how just school management can change all the output of the students. The evaluation method is an issue. The learning environment, the infrastructure, the facilities, the teachers' capacity, there are many elements involved when you talk about the quality of education. And as I mentioned, our governments were focusing on the quantities or the access to education, but leaving quality and relevance behind. And there's an opportunity today because this youth bulge is past us. We can focus on the quality, we can focus on proper long-term reforms rather than just providing access.
Another thing I'm often struck by is education, the other side of education, one is educating the student, the other is actually a stimulus for innovation, is the research. Israel has done a very good job of taking the research output of its universities and transforming that into products. We talked about Teva and others. Counterexample would be in Egypt, there are 50 state institutions that are doing very, very innovative research in agriculture and healthcare technology and others, and yet the product of that research sits on the shelf because there's no mechanism to actually get it to market. Do you see further, you know, by putting more resources into education, by building universities and other mechanisms, by making them more responsive, is that also part of the recipe for economic growth? Yeah, any of you.
Our governments have been putting 5% of the GDP on education. So, relatively speaking, that is a high percentage compared to most other regions. Higher education is geared towards providing diploma. What we're missing is, I don't think what we're missing is the resources, really. I mean, of course, resources, the more the merrier, but I don't think that is the problem. There has to be a reform. Our higher education has to be geared towards tooling students with the right skills, because the biggest problem today is the skills gap. We have a huge issue with the skills gap. We have a huge issue with people who don't want to work, economically inactive population, and we have a huge issue with, of course, hence unemployment.
Well, one point on this one, actually, again, it's very difficult to generalize because you've got pockets of success stories in different parts of the region. For example, Lebanon is, well, ranks number 7 in the world in mathematical education and science, for example. So you get very good quality education in places like Lebanon. And in places like Saudi Arabia, there's a lot of effort being spent on R&D. There are large budgets in the space of 10 billion Saudi riyals being spent on research with research institutions. And more recently, there were bodies created, organizations created, to take this research and commercialize it in a VC-like format. In the UAE, for example, you've got a lot of spending on R&D and development, a lot of investments in this area. And also at the same time, there's a lot of support for businesses to be established in the UAE. But you cannot actually have everything across the board in all the countries in the Middle East, which I believe also calls for a larger degree of regional integration in the region to be able to leverage all these capabilities across borders while creating a set of reforms to be able to normalize the quality of education, the quality of investments, attracting the right levels of investments in different areas of productivity in the markets. But one thing that's extremely important is that job creation. And to create jobs, you need to have growth. To have growth, you need to have investments. And to have investments coming into those markets, either local investments, regional investments, or international foreign direct investments, you need to have a certain level of market freedom and market openness and economic integration across the region and with the rest of the world. And for that to happen, you need to have a new set of policies, regulations on the main sectors, more privatization, better education, better healthcare, etc. And to do that, you need to have new leadership in many places, either a new style of leadership or a totally different structure of leadership altogether. And this is actually happening as we speak today, and it's a long process. But what's important about getting this change is not to do the change for the sake of change, because the current situation may not be appropriate or accepted by the general public, but to change into a new set of ideas, a leadership, a group of leadership that comes from a background of progressive thinking, from an open thinking, from a freedom-related thinking. And I'm just not just talking about social freedom and political freedom. I'm talking about economic freedom, which brings all other kinds of freedoms with it. Because you cannot have democracies without having an open market and free market economy come with it. So they go hand in hand. So the reforms and changes that are taking place in the region, we're all hopeful that they are extremely positive. And you can, in every single country in that part of the world, you can see some kind of a change happening to the better. What I think is needed right now is for the rest of the world to embrace that change and support it positively. And it's probably not the right time to take the back seat and watch it happening on its own, because there are the ingredients of a positive change that are taking place. It would be such a waste of opportunity to simply let it happen and watch it from a distance without the right level of support, the right level of engagement in a positive way. And this positive way would be to really engage with the civil society, to create the next wave of leaders, to educate the next wave of leaders, to invest in the right places, and to encourage the region to go into a more open market economy system that would eventually help sustain democracies, help sustain freedoms, and help sustain growth. Because this is a region where a significant amount of global GDP growth will come from, and many companies in the West, in the US, in Europe, and many organizations would actually be looking at the region either as a stepping stone for Southeast Asia later on, or as a market by itself that will bring an awful lot of value on investments.
So what you're talking about here is very much is not so much a government to government dialogue,
no.
But this is a business to business, NGO to NGO dialogue.
Absolutely.
Yoav?
I want to provoke a little bit the, you know, systematic thinking about policies and, you know, governments, and just a little story maybe. In the 50s and the 60s, if you would ask a kid in Israel what are his dream, what he wants to do in the future, he would tell you that he wants to be probably a lawyer or a doctor. If you will ask a kid in the last decades in Israel what he wants to do, he would like to have a startup and sell it to Google for many millions. That's the dream of everyone. And my question or my thought are, if it's not really starting about dreams, and what kids, what are their motivations? Do they have a strong enough motivation? Do they have, you know, big dreams? And I think it's equal or important as equally as, you know, policies and
right.
Structures.
No, absolutely. You know, we've got a couple more minutes, and then we're going to do about 10 minutes of Q&A. But not to put you on the spot, this is an action festival. So what types of concrete actions would you propose? Are there models out there? Are there things that can be done right now to start addressing some of these issues? Maybe Ghassan will start in the end, and we'll give the other two time to think.
Peace.
Peace.
Look, I think the question is beyond peace now. It's stability even before before peace. But I think the immediate action that needs to be taken right now is education in the wider sense. Investing in education, in opening the minds of people on what actually matters. Okay? I think today we probably need to move away. It is time to start moving away from an ideology-driven aspiration to a realistic sustainability or economic sustainability-driven aspiration. The region is full of entrepreneurs. By nature, by upbringing, by culture, the culture is quite entrepreneurial. What is needed right now in terms of concrete action is to channel investments into the right ideas and to educate those who are either coming to power or who are already in power with a manual of how do you actually sustain the positive prospects for your country. And that is basically what is needed now in terms of action. And the shift in thinking from the traditional way of governing, the traditional way of controlling and managing into a more open society, more collaborative systems, and an open channel for investments in the hopes and visions and aspirations of the youth population of the region is what is immediately needed. And that model we've seen happen in many places around the world. We've seen it happen in Southeast Asia, Singapore managed to, you know, create a great example out of a very difficult social economic situation when they were left out of Malaysia, and we are seeing also similar models emerging in the Middle East itself. We also have good success stories. Bahrain was a good success story. Jordan was a good success story. Although they haven't actually reached the openness that they need to have, but on an economic level, they managed to create open markets, a good level of competition, a good level of investments that came not from within the country, but from outside the country and the region.
So Dheema, in addition to guts, what else do we need?
We have opportunities. I mean, the demographic gift is an opportunity, very low dependency rate because the age group below 15 and above 64 is much less than the economically active population, supposedly. Our governments are under pressure, which is great. Back to Dr. King and the creative tension created. So now there is a creative tension being created. Our governments for many years thought that reforms can wait forever and that time is infinite. Today they realize that this is not the case, so this is a great opportunity. The private sector is stepping up. The civil society sector is shaping up in our region. We're starting to talk to each other, the three sectors, the civil society, the private sector, and the public. And I'm going to talk about Injaz as an example because it is a beautiful example that has proven success. Our graduates, and this is a study done by a third party, they did the study on all our graduates from year 2009 up to 2012. 89% of them find jobs immediately versus non-Injaz graduates, only 30% find jobs the first year. So 70% actually of Jordanians who graduate from schools or are looking for jobs wait for at least 1 year. And how we do that, we bring together in a direct relationship the business, the private sector, into schools. So private sector and academia dealing together, transfer of knowledge, of information, understanding the actual needs. We have different programs that tackle the issue of skills gap in specific, so lots of soft skills, interpersonal skills, leadership, ethical leadership skills, and lots of business skills. These programs are mainstreamed. We manage to mainstream them within the education system, so there is a class within the school hours that is called Injaz class, where we implement all our programs. We focus on motivation because it is absolutely very much needed and important. Career development, entrepreneurship. Just an example, this year 75 startups were created by our students in universities. Next year there will be 100 startups created by our students and so on. And the beauty of it all is that it is all being implemented through volunteers who are professional people from the private sector. People with business experience and background who go to school or students go to the business, they job shadow, they do internship. So they're getting a lot of related skills, a lot of the required skills. The private sector is very much involved, engaged directly in schools. The environment is being enhanced because, just an example, the school adoption, for example, where companies adopt schools and hence enhance the facilities and the infrastructure of these schools, lifting up the whole learning environment. So the model works. People want to make it work. There is absolutely today commitment at all levels. And I'm talking about Jordan in specific, but also I know other countries have the same thing as well. So there are other models that work as well.
Great. Well, I've been told that we're actually running out of time. So Yoav, I'm going to give you the last word.
I think Israel is kind of excluded from the regional game. So unfortunately, I hope that this is going to change. I think that there is business can hopefully drive and advance peace and vice versa. And from my narrow angle, I'm trying to help in creating business relationship with Palestinians, and that's working very well. I told you about that. Yes. So I hope that this is something that, by the way, in Israel at least, there is a consensus about the importance of, from the right wing and the left wing, about the importance of building a commercial and business relationship with the Palestinians. So I hope that this will really move forward.
Well, thank you very much.